On Periscope, are we? Okay, fine, we're live on Periscope. Anybody who doesn't know what Periscope is, put your hand up. Okay, you're dead. No, I'm daring you not to know what Periscope is. Right. Well, thank you all very much for coming. Who's the first timer at HealthChat? Anybody? Oh, you are, right. Well, first timer? I can't believe it, really. Well, it's very nice to see you. The purpose of HealthChats is exactly what it says. It's a chat about health. With people who have held very high and influential positions in the health service, people who still do, people who have a story to tell, and they're always very interesting. And the idea is to bring the sort of boardroom and the top line of the health system closer to the front line. We'll have a chat. There'll be some time for questions, and so don't go home thinking, "I wish I'd asked that question." Because tonight we have someone who was not only in high office, but also knew all about the health service changes, lived through the last lot of reforms. I think you and I have been through about 12 reforms, I think, probably. And none of it's got any better, but there we are. We can talk about that later on. I'm not coming to this with prejudice at all.
No opinions.
I'm neutral. And Acosta-Rista. It is important also that I mention the fact that we couldn't have these fabulous evenings without the help of our sponsors. It's IMS Maxims and Michael, who always says a few words at the beginning of these events, won't tonight because Shane, I think, is going to say. Is that right, or is it Michael? We're live on. Come on, Michael. You know you love this. Right. There we are. Is your mum watching again?
I had no idea you had celestial connections.
She's probably talking to my mum. They're getting together up there. They're saying, "We knew these two boys would never make anything of their lives."
I know.
Well,
I know,
one, anyway.
Yes. Well, never mind. We'll forgive you anyway. how do you follow him, for heaven's sake? Stephen, I daren't introduce. You've heard how wonderful he is, what an enormously influential position he's had. He did mention quietly that Roy could hardly be ruder to him than he was at the last occasion like this. So we look forward to seeing if Roy can be better than last time. And in the meantime, I commend you to their care.
Thank you very much. And we're enormously grateful to IMS Maxims. They've really looked after us over the years, and thank you for this much. And they have a new member of staff, and Natalie will come just say a few words. She's there. Can we quickly, come on. You've been eating in my... This is Natalie, ladies and gentlemen. She just joined IMS Maxims. There she is. And just say a few words, I think, you should say about your career, how pleased you are. What a wonderful employer IMS Maxims are. Okay, fine. Thank you very much. It's very nice to see you. Ladies and gentlemen, Stephen Dorrell. Right, is that your gin and orange or is that mine?
That's in fresh orange.
Fresh orange, good. Stephen, thank you.
Thank you for the invitation.
Stephen used to be my boss when I was the chairman of a trust.
Neither of us had grey hair then.
That's true. Well, actually, I had hair. But tell me, we like to find out a little bit about the background of people. Because you were in a family business. So what was that?
It was a family business in uniforms. It's been through a number of different formulations.
Natalie likes a man in uniform.
Right, okay. Yeah. Well, Natalie and I should speak later.
Yes. Clearly.
We have a long experience of uniforms.
Yes.
From there, I was in the House of Commons from 1979.
Why politics? What happened? What so destroyed your life that you wanted to become a member of Parliament?
It's a lot. Yes, that makes me splutter.
Yeah.
I quite often quote, do you remember John Pardo? He was a Liberal
MP.
Long ago, he used to describe politics as social work with a bit more razzmatazz.
Yes. Is that light flashing or am I having a stroke?
I'm just trying to find which one it is.
Social work with a bit more razzmatazz. It's the opportunity to make a difference, engage in, rather than just sitting and watching the television saying, if only they did it, actually being on the field of play and trying to do something about it.
Yeah. I mean, I often hear that. I mean, I was a local authority councillor, as you know, and I mean, I, I became a councillor because I just got completely exasperated and bloody annoyed with the council and thought, well, I'll have to go and sort this lot out. But
you know, did you find it did anything for your temper?
No. It honed it. And it just drove me completely bloody balmy. And then I ended up on the health authority, and it was even worse because it was it drove me balmy in a foreign language. But it is this question of making a difference. And I, you know, feeling that you want to make a difference or change things or what have you. It's got a kind of piety to the phrase, but it is right.
I think it is right, but I think it's important actually for people who do it, choose to do it in the public sector, never to lose sight of the fact that most people, when they go to work, do it in order to make a difference.
Yeah.
Very few people in life go to work with their mind on the pay. They go because they're going to make a contribution to their company or to the council or to the health
service. So Natalie would do well to remember.
This is all about motivation.
Yeah.
And so.
Well, it's good if you've got a job that you know you can do that. A lot of people, of course, do soulless, horrible jobs, don't they? That you need them to do, but.
But actually,
that's the employers.
That's the point that I'm making. Those that you look at them from the outside and you think, gosh, I'm glad I'm not doing that. They're members of teams, and if they're a good employer working in a good employment setting, then they understand what the contribution is they make to the bigger effort. It's the old NASA story. You know, what do you going to the guy who cleaned the loos at NASA? What's your job? My job is to be a member of a team that puts a man on the moon.
Yes.
And so everybody has a clear view of what it is their organisation is seeking to do.
Why do you think the NHS is such a bad employer?
Well, it's worth going through that vision of what a good employer is, because the best NHS organisations are very good employers. You go to the best NHS organisations and you do talk to the metaphorical person who cleans the loo, and they know why they're there as a member of the team. But too often, that sense that everybody works for the same purpose isn't as strong as it needs to be.
I had a really interesting exchange. I don't know if any of you followed me last night on Twitter, but I did 2 hours on Twitter about the junior doctor strike. And I published the letter that the employers sent to all of the junior doctors. It's a 7-page letter, ridiculously long, but it's a complicated offer. And, you know, we were kind of going through that. And there was a various exchange between a junior doctor, a woman junior doctor, who was also a mum, married to another junior doctor. And, of course, they do rotations. When they do rotations, they don't in advance get told what their shifts were. And, of course, if they don't know what their shifts are, they can't arrange their childcare. Mm-hmm. And because they're both junior doctors, there's no synergy between how they work their shifts.
Mm-hmm.
And what unraveled last night was it was a complete disaster. I don't know how these two managed, to be honest. Mm-hmm. And I said, have your trust got a creche?
Mm-hmm.
And they said, what's a creche? But it was like one of those sort of replies, you know, no, we don't. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking, you know, here we are. Biggest employer in the world, 70% are nurses, and of which, I mean, with every respect to male nurses, you probably have the same problems as well, but, you know, a huge number of women nurses who are caring responsibility. And you can count on the fingers of one hand the trusts with a creche.
Hmm. And it doesn't necessarily have to be the trust organising the creche. It has to be the trust as employer thinking about how it can be a good employer, engaging with the people who work for it, and giving purpose to their lives, and responding to the kind of questions that you're...
I mean, when you were the boss and I was running a trust, the first thing I did when I moved into the trust was to open a creche, because I could run it at marginal costs, and it was a lot cheaper.
Hmm. Well, sometimes it's for the trust to run a creche, sometimes... The issue is childcare, it isn't running a creche.
Yes.
And that can be the right solution in some contexts and not in others. I think the danger in an organisation the size of the health service is that somebody, whether they're a trust chief executive or the NHS chief executive, Simon Stevens, or the Secretary of State, says, What we want is crashes in trusts. And you, before you know what's happened, every trust in the country has gone around ticking the box, opening a creche. And actually, what you want is childcare, or what you want is the ability for people who work in the organisation to discharge their family caring responsibilities and to turn up at work and feel fulfilled when they get there. And if you start with that rather than the creche, you get to somewhere closer to the right place.
Maybe. Anyway, so well, there you are. You pitched up.
You've more chance of getting.
No, you, I don't think you have. Do it. If you need a creche, build one. Sort it out.
Yeah. First ask. First find out whether you need one. Don't do it just because the Secretary of State says it's
let's
a good
idea. Let's not get bogged down. The Secretary of State never has a good idea. With some exceptions, of course. So there you are. Was it your first seat? Did you get...
Loughborough was my first seat in 1979.
Yeah. And then you
well, it wasn't...
Was it the boundary changes?
It wasn't the first seat I fought. The first seat I fought was in 1974 against John Prescott in Hull.
Really?
I was a Tory candidate in around the fish docks in Hull at the height of the Cod War. Those aged over 50 will remember, or over 60,
so that was a very
will remember the Cod War.
That was a winnable seat then. What went wrong?
I say, I fought East Hull and East Hull fought back.
Oh, what a lovely experience. Yeah. So you find out you pitched up where you are, first day.
First day in 1979. I'd been around the place a little bit. I'd worked with Peter Walker.
Yeah, now he was interesting, wasn't he? Because, again, like your business background brought a whole perspective that I think in modern politics we're missing now, where we have so many sort of professional politicians out of university, bad carrying job, become an MP, very little experience of life. Well, I like Walker very much.
Right, he and Michael Heseltine hunted as a pack, and I was the dog's body following along behind. I worked with Peter until, well, all through my first parliament, was kind to me, and then I became his PPS in 1983 during the miners' strike. It was very interesting, I quite often tell this story. Peter asked me to be his PPS, his bag carrier, just after the 83 election. And he said to me, this was after a weekend thinking about the new the Department of Energy, his new job. He said, during this parliament, we're going to have two issues we've got to deal with. One is that there's a confrontation coming with the NUM in the coal mines, and we have to deal with that. And assuming we live to tell the story, the second half of the parliament will be about gas privatisation. If you look back at the story of the Department of Energy, it's focusing on the important rather than getting lost in the detail.
What was it like then? I mean, the Thatcher government came pretty close to a sticky end, didn't they, really?
Several times.
Yeah.
But that's the... if you're going to do something worthwhile, you have to work out what your key objectives are. And you have to be willing to take risks. And that's true of whether you're running a government or running a trust or anything else. You have to be, but they have to be well-judged
but
risks.
They had stockpiled quite a lot.
And you have to know when to retreat. People think of Margaret Thatcher as the person who won every single battle. Actually, Margaret Thatcher was a very shrewd politician, and she knew when to retreat as well. Everybody remembers the coal strike of 1984-5, if I remember my dates right. What people don't remember so well is the retreat ahead of the 1983 election, when we weren't going to win, in order to ensure that we were in a position where we could take on an important battle and win it.
Stockpile the coal.
Exactly.
The lights were kept on, weren't they?
And, well, that was part of it. It was also about securing support within the mining industry. If you remember, it was...
The Nottingham miners carried on.
Exactly. Yeah. There was, I forget the precise proportions, but it was about a quarter of the workforce of the
NCB. It was a small number, but it was very significant, wasn't it?
Well, it was not an insignificant number. It was, I think, from memory, around a quarter kept working, which wasn't enough to keep the power stations going indefinitely, but it was certainly enough to enable the government to win the confrontation.
My local MP was Michael Grewals at the time. Of course, he was the head honcho of the Small Business Bureau, and
I was
involved with that. And I remember we used to meet, you know, quite a lot over the strike and the impact it had on small businesses, and I got quite involved really in some of the politics of it. But it was a sticky old time, because I don't think anybody was prepared to see the 6 o'clock news where people were having running battles with the police. Mm. It's not how Britain does things. Mm. And it was a big shock to everyone, I think. Well, polarized the nation.
It was a polarizing event. That's undoubtedly true. It was a very political event.
Remember Arthur that Scargill
made it crystal clear that it was a political challenge to the government.
Yes, it was. And you remember the Christmas when it was on and people were sending parcels and all that. I had a very difficult time with my mum. Who said we should be sending off parcels. I'm saying, you rather laugh. And it was quite an interesting time. Okay, so we soldiered through all that lot. Yeah. And then you got, what was your first ministerial job?
Health. Well, I did 3 years in the Whip's office.
Yes.
In the late 80s.
You're too nice to be a Whip, aren't you?
Whips have
the answer's not no.
There's a story I occasionally tell of I was told when I went into the Whip's office, there's a simple principle in the Whip's office: you never kick a man unless he's down.
All businessmen make a note of it. Periscope. Business tip of the day. Our job is not to sit here and get worried. Our job is to sit here and make some other poor bastard worry. So you did, and then
that's the popular image of the Whip's office.
It is.
It's actually not true. The Whip's office is there to avoid conflict in Parliament. It's not just to say to backbenchers, this is the government's policy, you need to support it. It's actually to make certain that the government is in touch with what's going on with a backbench opinion, so that the party more or less holds together.
I think that's a very benign description.
It's like, there are various other organisations, which I won't name, that have the same function in other countries.
Right, so your first ministerial job in health, John Major, wasn't it?
I was appointed by Margaret Thatcher.
Yeah.
Ken Clark was the Secretary of State.
Yes.
This was in the run-up to the. I was appointed just a few weeks before the final passage of the 1990 Act.
Right.
And was there all through the implementation of it.
Ken Clark, I thought he was a great Secretary of State for Health, really. I mean,
and of various other things.
Yes, I mean, the fact he's still going is amazing. The reforms, really, if we look back at those reforms, they seem a very small change now in today's climate. But at the time, the idea of giving a hospital its head to do things, it was just amazing. I mean, I'd come from being the chairman of a health authority where I had special responsibility for Frimley Park, and effectively ran Frimley Park as a member of the health authority. Mm. You know, the concept of recruiting somebody, and I recruited Andrew Morris, who is still there, and I take all for the success of Frimley Park.
Yes.
But, I mean, that actually was the turning point, I think, probably, wasn't it?
Well, you see, I actually don't really agree that the 1990 Act was minor and relatively small beer by comparison with what came
after. No, I'm looking
after.
Back.
Yeah.
But at the
I
time,
actually think it was the turning point.
Yes.
I think it was very clearly was the turning point. And it's one of the things I say quite often, is that it's an endearing characteristic of the British. That having got an idea, we've then legislated it three times. We legislated it in 1990. Alan Milburn re-legislated it again in 2002. And Andrew Lansley re-legislated again in 2012.
No, he screwed it up.
But the fundamental proposition there should be a distinction between the function of a commissioner and the function of a provider, that's what was introduced in 1990. The rest of it is actually
we call it the purchase of provider
split. Well, in those days it was purchase of provider. These days it's commissioner provider.
Yeah. Virginia Bottomley got into a tangle with the purchase of provider split, as I remember.
I'm not going to. I think you need to be a little more specific if you're going to ask me to comment on that.
No, we won't go there. So what was happening at the time? I mean, one gets the impression really that Margaret Thatcher had got completely exasperated with the health service. You know, keep chucking money into it, never really got anything back for it other than a load of grief. She went. Then, subsequently, John Major came in. What was the thinking at the time of those reforms?
Well, the thinking was that then it's the thinking then is the same as the thinking of the Blair government in the Milburn era, and it's very similar thinking now, that there needs to be a commissioner who is responsible for seeking to secure improvements in the quality of health and care services delivered to a locality, making services more accountable to their patients and users, and looking at alternatives that are available in a particular locality, so that it isn't a question of funding a current trust or a healthcare provider directly. It's a question of funding a commissioner to look for the best value, high quality solution for a particular locality. It's that creative tension. It was called the internal market. Yeah. I mean, it's never really developed into a market, but the proposition that there is something different in the function of a commissioner from the function of the manager of Frimley Park or another big acute trust, that proposition was what Ken Clark introduced in 1990, and that's what we're still working through today. We'll come on to talk about the modern application of that.
Yes, but I don't want to underplay at all the size of the reform, but when you're thinking of, we've come a long distance, but I think it is right that he opened the door for much more. And as you say, Milburn came in. I mean, if you actually look at the key, the greater involvement of the private sector, the foundation trusts, actually there's very little difference between a foundation trust and an ordinary trust. You look at the legislation, it's just about disposal of assets, really. But he parceled it up to look like it was a bigger reform and other things. Milburn pushed the envelope, I think, much more.
Yeah, Milburn actually made all the same speeches Ken had made and I'd made and Virginia had made. But the important difference, of course, was that Alan was from the Labour side of the divide. And so if you look at the evolution of health policy from 1990 to 2010, there was reasonably consistent evolution under Ken Clark, Virginia and myself between 1990 and 1997. Frank Dobson then came in, he's the one health secretary, the only health secretary actually between 1990 and 2016, who rejected absolutely in terms the proposition that I just advanced, that there's a difference between commissioner and provider. Frank doesn't agree with that. Everybody else in the progression has, to varying degrees, agreed with it. And what Milburn and the Blair government did, having had a detour under Dobson, was to go back to the logic that Ken Clark had introduced in 1990.
And that was the time Simon Stevens was making his name, wasn't it?
Simon Stevens was right. Simon Stevens and Alan Milburn were working hand in glove.
Yes.
Simon in number 10 and Alan in the department.
And then they invented primary care trusts. What a good idea that was.
This is brass plate country, isn't it?
Yeah.
What was the difference between PCTs, as they ultimately became, and the health authorities that you knew in the original Clark legislation? There were differences, and there are differences that we're still working through. What Alan had correctly seen was that you needed to introduce a more clinical viewpoint than the original health authorities had demonstrated.
Well,
but in truth, the PCT never delivered that, which is why we got into the debate about CCGs, but we're not out of that wood yet.
No, they were just a sprawling mess. But the district health authority was an accountable care organisation, wasn't it? We were responsible for the whole of the budget, for the whole of the service delivery. We made a mess of it because we didn't have really the technology to know where the money was going. We used to get a lump of money from the Treasury in the beginning of the year, divide it by 12, and that was our allocation.
Precisely. The District Health Authority you just described was pre-1990. And
yes.
It was to create tension between the commissioner and the provider. That was the key idea in the 1990 legislation. And that's what we're still working out today. That's what Howard Bernstein's doing in Manchester.
Yeah.
Is working out what the role of the commissioner is in a more devolved management structure.
I don't want to rush my fences because I'd like to talk a bit more about the reformed NHS, but it, just for the purposes of picking up the thread of that conversation, now people are starting to question whether or not commissioning has a role vertically integrated, capitated, population-based budgets. People say to me, the hospitals will suck in all the money. Well, I think we're better at the money now because if you can imagine, when I've started, it was before Microsoft, it was before Excel spreadsheets. I mean, we used to have graph paper to do the money on, you know.
Slide rules.
Exactly, we did. And so, you know, the handling the allocations was very, very difficult. But now we can be much more transparent. And I think the attitude of the hospitals probably has changed quite a bit, particularly with the incentives that there are in the system now to get people moving through the system. Can you see an end to commissioning?
I think there are two thoughts in that
polemic
observation, if I may suggest. The one is that we're better at the money, and I was just reflecting as you were talking that I think there's slender evidence for that in the system at the moment.
No, I'm not going to let you get away with that. No. The reason the hospitals are over, the hospitals aren't overspent. They're under-resourced for the volume.
Oh, silly me.
For the volume of business that's going through the system. And I don't know, I think it was, it might have been enough of some of the other think tanks. I copied their graph and put it on Twitter today. The NHS has outperformed the economy in a huge amount in terms of efficiency gains.
Be interested to see that evidence for that. I don't think that's true. I absolutely accept that there is a problem. That there is, we need to look at rising demand and ask ourselves how we're going to match that. I absolutely agree with that. I think actually one of the core problems is that the health service, the NHS, is relatively efficient by international standards. I think that is true. I don't think it's true that the efficiency has grown in the health service faster than the economy as a whole. I think that's quite a difficult argument.
Sure, somebody will have the graph on my Twitter. Have you got it there? Yeah, we'll show you later. But it's true. I think it's the perfume Jennifer's lot down at the Health Foundation or whatever it's called. Anyway,
I should be interested to see it.
Yes, we'll show you, and we'll put it on Twitter for anybody that's watching on.
What I think is true, and this is where. This is the challenge, and why, incidentally, I think there's an enhanced role, not a diminished role for commissioning, is that in order to deliver genuine efficiency for the health and care budget, we have to get beyond the silo of the NHS and start thinking about a health system rather than a system which rations access to the treatment of illness, which is the system that too often we operate.
Well,
at the
that's
moment.
A big philosophical leap, isn't it? I mean, I'm surprised, really, that. That you are keen. I mean, are you keen on commissioning because that's where most of your members are at the Confed? Are you?
No, we have we have provider members of all sorts, and we have commissioner members.
Let's ask the audience. Who thinks that commissioning's had its day? Put your hand up. You think commissioning's had its day? Put your hand up if you don't think it's had its day. And put your hand up if you don't know why I'm talking. You just want to have a glass of wine at that other something. Well, you can see there, most people think that commissioning has had its day.
Well, most people, I think if I'm fair, if you're fair with the number of hands went up, most people are non-combatants of this argument.
Let's put your hand up again. I'm sure I'm right. Put your hand up if you think that commissioning has had its day. Put your hand up. Look at that overwhelming majority.
Yeah. rather fewer than half the people present, actually.
They can't see it.
I know they can't. That's why I'm offering you a different interpretation. Let me tell you why I think commissioning is actually a key part of the future. And Manchester's the best way of illustrating this. If what we want is a set of public services that delivers care and support to people and avoids unnecessary illness, then surely to goodness, for example, how can you deliver efficient childcare if you don't involve the schools, you don't involve the GPs, you don't involve the housing managers? Does anybody seriously think that schools, housing, as well as community health, as well as acute hospital, should all be run by the same bureaucracy?
No, but commissioning isn't robust enough to do that.
Now, that's a completely different argument.
No, it's not.
It is an absolutely different argument.
It underpins the whole thing if they can't do it.
I think the people who've done commissioning rather better than NHS commissioners are local authorities.
Yes, I agree with that.
And so what's going on in Manchester, and what I hope will go on more broadly through the health and care system, is one that brings local authorities to the table, restores a stronger local voice in health service accountability, and sees the health service where it should be, which is embedded in a health and care sector, rather than a beacon on the hill, divorced from the rest of public services.
Are we talking about the Department of Health and Social Care?
We're talking about, we're actually talking about place-based public services. We're talking about a national health service responsible for clinical standards and economic efficiency and regulation and all that. But public services for the city, for the citizens of Greater Manchester require, in my view, a much stronger voice for local, for the local structures in Greater Manchester than we've seen historically. And the health service, as I've said, embedded in public services in Manchester rather than something divorced from public services in Manchester.
You don't see a queue of people wanting to be Devo, do you? Leeds turned
you
it
see,
down, Birmingham
you
don't
see
want to
too
do
many,
it.
Well, you see several local leaders taking the classic view of recent local government, which is that the health service is very difficult, which is true. But how do you deliver a joined up childcare service without putting education, housing, social care and the health service in the same room? I don't get it.
I think that's making it far too complicated.
No, it isn't. It's absolutely not making it complicated. The complication is trying to run a child health service divorced from education. It's impossible. It's not complicated, it's impossible.
I think you're slightly changing the basis of the argument, but I'll let you get away with it.
Well, I'm answering if I may
say...
It's
very boring. I'm falling asleep here.
Well, I'm sorry if I'm boring you, right? What I'm trying to do is to answer your question about commissioning. And the answer is, commissioning is something the health service does to itself. You can say it's boring, bureaucratic, and disinterested. If commissioning is part of reshaping public services so they're built around citizens, then I don't think it's boring. I think it's at the heart of modern politics.
No, do I mean? I'm just pulling your leg. But I mean, what?
No, but I'm.
But aren't we saying really that commissioning in the context of health services really? We need another name to broaden. The ability to bring together and commission whatever they contract for. I hate the idea of that, but you know, draw together in a strategic offering across the whole platform of public sector. I mean, I do get that.
Okay. Well, in that case, we're agreed. Yeah. And if you want to call it something other than commissioning,
well,
that's fine.
I think that's where
I think public service reform needs to go.
We're going to have to scrape that off our boots, I think. We're going to certainly have to come up with a sort of a more novel way of describing what it is. And does that mean that, I mean, we talk, I think, in health services rather arrogantly about the health services should take over adult social care. I mean, maybe it's the other way around, that the local government should run health services like they did in 1960, I think,
We don't need to go into the history.
Yeah.
I am not in favour of purely local health services. The concept of a national health service with national standards of clinical care, national standards of access, that I'm wholly signed up to, a national formulation of the free offer, if you like, of a national health service funded out of general taxation. That, I think, is something that if anyone was ever tempted to question that, you run into all kinds of political opposition, and I'd be on the side of the opposition. What I'm absolutely in favour of is taking that national health service but embedding it in local public services, rather than believing that it's something different from local public services, which I think is the mistake that we've increasingly made over the last 20, 30 years.
It's a mindset issue. And it's interesting also, I mean, to talk to you about you're not an MP anymore, but I mean, the Tories generally have scored pretty badly on health services. You know, everybody thinks that, they want to sell them off to Sainsbury's and all the rest of it, and the Thatcher reforms when, you know, the first 50 NHS Trust chairman turned up.
You know, one of the great ironies of political history in this country is that the man who brought the private sector into the delivery of healthcare was an Aaron Bevan.
Yeah.
because it was an Aaron Bevan that did the deal with the GPs in 1948 that made them private contractors delivering a public service.
Well, it's a bit of a stretch, but
it's not a stretch at all. It's fact.
Only the fact he couldn't do the deal any other way.
No, well, that's also true.
Well, exactly. You're going to rewrite history.
But private contractor delivering public services was an Aaron Bevan's idea.
It was the only deal he could get, and he was running out of time.
I don't deny you're right.
He wouldn't have done that.
He signed up to it.
Well, I think that was all he could do anyway. I mean, people don't trust the Tories on health, do they? I mean, I get letters every day. Oh, well, they're running the health service down just so that that Cameron can flog it off to his mates. Discuss.
No. I think the simple riposte to that is that if the Tory party had a deep-seated desire to sell off the NHS, there have been Tory governments with quite big majorities, much bigger than David Cameron's majority, over the last 70 years. Don't you think we might have got around to it sometime in that period?
Well, I think they've sort of had a go at bits of it, haven't they? Well,
is the short answer.
Well, I think I probably have to put my hands up and say I'm probably not right. It's not right to say that. But the current opinion is that, you know, they want to get rid of it to their mates and so on. And if you look at Circle, for example, and I mean, it turned out to be a disaster for the company. They lost 5 million, paid 2 million to get out of the deal. So it cost them 7 million quid to prove that they couldn't run a 350 bed hospital.
Can I bring you away from the anecdote? And there are anecdotes of failure in the private sector, anecdotes of failure in the public sector. Come away from the anecdote to the thing that everybody talks about, the health service, the health and care system. It needs to be a single system, from the acute sector through community services, through primary care, through social care, so that you deliver joined-up public services. This is the Manchester thesis all over again. Now, nobody seriously thinks, or at least I've never heard anybody argue, that all of that range of services currently provided by public, voluntary and private sectors should all be nationalised. So what we've got is a joined-up sector where there are public sector, there are public institutions delivering service, there are not-for-profit services being delivered, and there are private sector. And actually, at the margin, it's quite difficult sometimes to work out which side of these dividing lines these different organisations are, because most of us don't really care. What we're worried about and concerned about is delivering decent public services. As I enjoy doing this when I go as a guest to the Labour Party conference, as I do occasionally, and I enjoy saying to them, when it comes to the question of who owns the providers of public service, I'm a straightforward Blairite. It really annoys them. what matters is what works. And that's back to commissioner provider. The commissioner uses public funds to deliver high quality services to the public. Victor Adebiwala, he has a good line on this. Public service is a service delivered to the public. And who delivers it actually doesn't matter.
Yeah, well, he runs one of these big organisations.
A not-for-profit. He runs a not-for-profit organisation.
Yes, the contracts with the NHS, of course. Yeah. So, I mean, where are we now, do you think? I mean, most people seem to think that the NHS is in a god almighty mess. Let's talk about the Lansley reforms that you were so keen on.
Hang on a second. you'd have some difficulty standing up that proposition.
I just want to see if you're awake. I have to say this, I don't know why I'm going to be nice to you, but I thought you were magnificent during that whole... you were able to... I think I wrote about you, and I said, he's the only man I know that can walk the passages of Whitehall and not leave a footprint. Which is,
I don't know being nice or not.
Wove your way through. I mean, and I must just tell you this, I was at the House of Lords this afternoon, where I've got the rat-catching... contract. No, I'm just and I on the way out, I walked through the very tiny library corridor, and then coming the other way, I couldn't believe my eyes was Andrew Lansley, and I thought, this is not going to end so well. Anyway, he was.
You looked for a door.
I did. I tried to pretend I was a book, but he was charming. And said, how pleased he was to see me.
I'm sure he was.
Yes, and I invited him to come and sit in this chair, and he said he would consider it. So, you never know. If only we could find a sponsor for a bumper event like that. I don't know. That might be good. I mean, it was an almighty box, wasn't it? A complete mess.
Look, I voted for it.
Yes. Well, I was going to remind you.
I'll volunteer that. And there are some aspects of the reforms, of those Lansley reforms, that I think will actually stand the test of time.
Well, can we just go back a bit? Because I followed Andrew Lansley round doing NAPC conferences, mm-hmm. National Association of Primary Care, and I must have chaired a dozen of them, and I knew his speech off by heart. And you know, he was saying, reduce the number of PCTs, docs in the driving seat, management cost cap, job done. And then we all thought, yeah, we'll have some of that. And then suddenly, after the weekend of the election, a document was produced that talked about doing away with PCTs and just chucking the whole lot up in the air. Where did that come from?
I think it's fair to say it came as a bit of a surprise to quite a lot of people, you and me. It's one of the things we have in common, is that
Did it come as a surprise to Andrew Lansley? Because he didn't negotiate. He wasn't involved in the negotiations of the health policy.
Let's start with the things that I think Andrew was always right about, and I think it's a tragedy that he didn't deliver.
Well, I want to know how we got there.
Well, what he was seeking to do, if you remember, before 2010, he wanted the Department of Health to be renamed the Department of Public Health, and he wanted there to be more emphasis on prevention, early intervention. He wanted a set of institutions that were
better. They're stuffed up the back passage of the town hall.
Yeah, and... Well, I actually think they're in the right place. The back passage of the town hall, but in local government. I think public health should never have been taken out of local government, which it was in 1974 by Keith Joseph.
Do you think it's too big, sprawling? It's Porton Down and pork sausages. Should it be broken up, do you think?
So what should be broken up?
Public Health England. Is it too big?
Well, no, I don't think it is too big. Public Health England is not the whole of public health. In fact, it's not the majority of public health.
But it's
the focus of public health is in local government. Are you sure you're talking about Public Health England being too big, or do you mean NHS England?
No, Public Health England is too big.
Do you?
Well, anyway, don't worry about it. I want to know what happened that weekend when the discussions were held behind closed door. Lansley wasn't involved in developing health policy. It was the bloke who wrote the Orange Book and your Oliver Nutcase, whatever his name is, Letwith. How did that happen?
Well, I mean, you've no doubt read all the books that the coalition built. I wasn't there, no. I was in Parliament. I was strongly in favour of the creation of the coalition.
We've got that, yeah.
What happened was the health policy... Andrew could have developed health policy in the context of the coalition agreement in a variety of different ways. He chose to do it the way that
did he
did.
Did he choose, or was it forced on him?
No, I don't think Andrew has ever claimed that his policy was forced on him. Quite the contrary, I think that the fact of the matter is that Andrew developed a set of ideas which were then legislated in the 2012
Act. Everybody was saying this isn't going to work. Most people have been proved right, really. You know, it's one of those rare occasions where, you know, often people are hostile to policy because it affects them in some way or other, but governments had to do what governments do and govern. But here we had a set of policies which was a car crash in the making. The Prime Minister panicked and had the pause, and then you got, field in to do whatever it was you wanted him to do, and he did it. And, you know, we've ended up with a bloody awful mess. What was going on? Why weren't people listened to? What were MPs doing? How the hell did that happen?
What happened, I think I've already said, was actually that for the third time, Parliament re-legislated the same policy, re-legislated the commissioner-provider split. What happened? Actually, if you look on the provider side of the health service, there was relatively limited disruption. Actually, what happened in the 2012 Act was that we tore up the commissioning plant, looked at the roots, and restructured it yet again. And then we wonder, back to the debate we were just having, why commissioning doesn't work.
And there's because, no strategic overview?
Part of the answer to that question, I think, is that we have never allowed purchaser, as we called it in the 90s, commissioning, as it was renamed in the noughties, We've never allowed that to develop. Now, Andrew was actually right, in my view, to say that one of the problems with commissioning as he inherited it was that it didn't have a sufficiently strong clinical voice engaged in the commissioning process. So bringing clinicians into the commissioning process, I think, was a right, a good idea.
And before the election, he said that. Docs in the driving seat. Yeah. So the
I'm not in favour of docs in the driving seat. I am in favour of docs engaged in the process.
I've just paraphrased that. But I mean, he was going to, because if you remember, PCTs had multi-layers, and the PEC was one of the professional executive committee. Mm. He said, get rid of the PEC and, you know, put, you know, in inverted commas, docs in the driving seat, give them a much more. And I think clinical commissioning, we all kind of got that. Mm. And we got PCTs, 150 of them, who are in Britnall's world-class commissioning scores had just started to bear fruit. The scores were going up, they were getting better at it. Destroyed the whole bloody lot, put a bunch of amateurs in 230 different new organisations.
212, I think.
No, it is now, 212 now, but they, it was 230 then. I mean, why did Parliament go along with it?
This is a broader constitutional point, isn't it? It's governments with a majority. Well, governments,
what does that mean?
It means something quite important. It's rather beyond health chat, but whether governments...
Excuse me?
rather beyond the remit of health chat. But it's when governments with a majority...
Sponsor.
We could have a debate about constitutional theory.
Oh, we could sell tickets.
Yeah, well, precisely. exactly right. But the governments with a majority of 80, which is what the coalition had, find them comparatively rarely find themselves with a serious parliamentary challenge to their proposals, which is the argument about second chamber and the balance of power between Whitehall and Westminster and all that. That's what I mean by the different debate.
Yeah.
And what happened on the Health and Social Care Act was a classic. It's actually the best example in recent history of a government with a big majority and an idea which Parliament wasn't an effective challenge for.
Do you think they because Lansley presented himself as the man on health and he'd been in the shadow for a long time, do you think they just trusted him to get on with it?
Well, I think, yes, that's spot on. I mean, you know, Andrew, the more recent history wasn't a continuation of this story. The fact of the matter is, in the period pre-2010 election, Andrew Lansley was the only Tory spokesman in living memory, myself included, to be ahead of Labour in terms of public trust on health. So a Tory spokesman that is ahead of Andy Burnham in terms of public trust, it's not surprising that David Cameron, who'd known Andrew Lansley for a very long time, thought this guy, he'd got it right in the run-up to the election and gave it, and he'd earned some freedom of manoeuvre.
But he panicked, didn't he? Cameron panicked and then made the speech at Ealing. Well, I think he made a rush, because you know, I heard the story of meeting hospitals. It was an unscheduled visit to Ealing Hospital. Why Ealing? You know, come on.
I don't know the history of the visit to Ealing Hospital. I do know the history of the debates within the government.
What happened? The
legislation was getting into more and more difficulty, and there was a view taken, not, I think, as a panic, but as a response to developing political pressure, that something needed to be done to reboot, is the word that's in the back of my mind, and you get to the point where you can't actually think of the right word, but to reboot that political discussion. That's what the pause was all about.
Yeah, and then we had the pause, and that offered really very little. I think most people were disappointed with that.
I think it established some support for what was being done, and as I very often say, it brought that act brought clinicians into the commissioning process. That, I think, is a tick in the box. Your point about public health, I think public health is now in the right place. I think the public health reforms in that act are actually a step forward. And the other thing that I suspect in the end will prove to have been the biggest idea, although it's arguably the smallest one in the legislation, but the one that will have the longest endurance, is the health and wellbeing boards. Because if you...
Do you really think so?
Yeah, I do. Not in their current form, but it's the first time that the all the rhetoric that every health minister going back to the 1960s has talked about the need to knit health and social care properly together, the Health and Wellbeing Board is the first institution created by Parliament that actually has the task of trying to do that rather than just talk about it.
I heard a rumour that the next allocations are going to be part of the allocations to health and social, local government. Part of it will be a joint allocation for adult social care and health, because it overcomes some of the technical difficulties in joint working.
And yes, I don't quite know how you do a joint allocation to two accounting officers, but I'd be interested in that.
Well, they decide on who it is.
But whatever the legality of it, I mean, the Better Care Fund has already established the principle that it goes into the NHS vote, but is actually spent on social care.
Which I understand might be ultra-virus.
Well,
health services can't buy social care, because social care has its own money voted to it by Parliament, and healthcare has its money voted to it by Parliament. They can agree jointly on joint endeavour, but you can't just give health money to social care and let them go off and buy it. That's part of the difficulty with the Better Care. I mean, the Better Care Fund, which is just a way of bunging social services, £1 billion worth of health service money.
Well, that's one way of putting it. What it was doing was requiring in a local health economy the health service and social care to work together. Rather, it's this word collaborate that is loved in this sector. Has a rather different historical connotation, which is why I always rather resisted using it. But anyway, the
conspiratorial.
As I've already said, health ministers have forever talked about the importance of these public services collaborating, but they've never done it. And what the Better Care Fund did is to put some money, to attach some money to cooperation. And it required, at least at some level, cooperation, partnership working between two different statutory agencies. I think it's a step in the right direction, but I think it's a relatively small one.
Devo Manx sets us off in the right direction. Do you think that Cameron might have a go at some kind of a merger, a proper framework merger, or would he just let it sort of grow?
It goes back to the debate we were having about public services in a locality. I'm not in favour of merging the providers. What I'm in favour of doing is empowering commissioners to get different providers from the statutory sector, the voluntary sector and the private sector to deliver joined up public services. So it's back to Howard Bernstein's point. What matters in Manchester is Manchester pounds. How many pounds are spent, whether it's by DWP, the Department of Health, the local authorities?
But this is regional government, isn't it?
It's local government. It's Greater Manchester. It's a sub-region.
Yeah. Let's go back to when you were the Secretary of State. We'll come back to reforms in a minute. But tell us, what actually happens in Cabinet? We're not gossips.
Well, we're virtually at the point where you can read it. It's nearly 30 years ago. I'm quite fond of saying I was... Health Secretary in Gladstone's second administration. It's all a very long time ago. The answer is that when I was in the Cabinet, there were 24 people, I think it is, sat around the table. It's even more now. That's not a...
Awkward table, isn't it?
Yeah, it's an awkward table, and that's not a meeting at which you confide and have a sort of cosy discussion teasing out the issues, is it? It's a meeting where you come with a proposal and you seek to get, if you've got any sense, you've worked out which of the people round the table are likely to cause you trouble, and you've had a private conversation with them before you get there, and you get it through Cabinet with a minimum of fuss. Bad news, I mean, this is nothing unique to Cabinet about this. If you get a meeting of 25 people and you're invited to present a proposal, well, you present the proposal, and you then hope that it goes through in the next 5 minutes, because if you're still talking about it an hour later, you're lost.
Yes, yeah. It's the same in council, isn't it? You can get the bike sheds through, but £1 million goes through, but the bike sheds you can never get through.
Exactly.
So yeah, it's not... is it a kind of report and arrangement, really? I mean, what is the point of Cabinet, given that... is it just a formal... stamping of it? I mean, what is the point, really?
The point is that it's we run a government on the basis of collective responsibility. You have a colleague who runs health, you have a colleague who runs education, a colleague who runs the treasury and so forth, and you are a team of people and you sink or swim together. I mean, I was a member of a cabinet where there were some quite sharp divisions, if you remember, in the run-up to 1997, and you could argue that we sunk together because we didn't have sufficiently strong collective view on the difficult issues that we faced. And when cabinets are successful, they have a clear and shared view. And whatever the differences of nuance between Roy Lilly and Stephen Dorrell, we both go out and I defend your policy and you defend mine. Mm-hmm. And that's how teams work.
Yeah, I think we might be revisiting some of that with the European thing. Yeah.
Not going there.
No. I don't think any of us really. Well, we've got months of that. Well, we haven't actually. Till June, haven't we? You've got a European office at the Confed, haven't you? What a bloody waste of money, really.
I wouldn't describe it as a waste of money, but there is an agenda in the European Union for cooperation on things like cross-border disease prevention, cross-border flows of patients. That's increasingly important, and those are issues that the Confed European officer is engaged with.
What about the Confed? As you know, I mean, I was instrumental in starting it with John Greetham and all the rest. We used to come to meetings with you.
It was a slightly different organisation in those days.
Well, that's what I was going to get onto, really, because William Wardegrave gave John and I $5,000 mm-hmm. to go away and start the Federation of NHS Trusts, because he said, William always spoke like that, he said, I need to know what's going on. I'll give you my phone number. And, don't want any surprises, chaps, you know. And then Phil Harris went away in the first week. He made 500 people redundant. It was just a disaster. Anyway, we got our way through that. But we set up the Federation of Ministers Trust, and the idea was that it was for chairman to be able to have a direct line to the minister. It was all very new, and you know, it was all very risky, or was perceived as very risky. It probably wasn't. But now, of course, it's developed into this great sprawling organisation that claims to represent everybody and therefore can represent no one. Really, you've got competing interests within your membership. I mean, what direction are you going to take it in?
Well, I've sought to set out this evening what I think is the core of where health and care policy needs to go. The Confederation has commissioners in its membership. It has mental health trusts. It has the National Association of Primary Care is associated with us. We have a lot of acute members. So, of course, there are differences of interest between those different elements within the Confederation. But the health and care sector, I think, ought to have a clear view.
Will you seek to have social care in your membership?
It's one of the things we are actively talking about with the local government association. Is not to have, and the LGA clearly is a different organisation, but we have a shared interest in the development of a joined-up view of health and care, as I've been discussing this evening.
What do you, I mean, if you take a, let's take an thing at the moment, you know, the letter that, well, I actually had a legal letter and published it, but the Guardian picked it up, this letter from the TDA, Bob Alexander, saying we're coming to sort you out, and if that means cutting your head count, so be it. I mean, it's a disastrously stupid thing to do, and it takes us on the road back to mid-staffs. But, you know, monitor is monitor. Will you advise your members not to do that?
Well, I'm not sure it's our job to advise members on the detail of the management of their trust.
Well, it's a big issue, isn't it? I mean, we've got everybody, we can't bust the Dell. We all understand that.
Yeah,
we're miles away from sorting that out. We've got to scrape every shilling from down the back of the sofa. And you know, there you've got a very senior person in the NHS saying we can't bust the Dell, you've got to keep to your budget, you cannot bust your budget, and if that means you've got to let people go, you're going to do it. Now, if I was in the Confederation now, I'd say over my dead body, you can bugger off, because we're not going to do it. You find another way.
Well, every organisation has to live within a budget, and so there are plenty of organisations in the health service that deliver very high quality, consistent care and live within their budget.
There are some, I wouldn't say plenty. Was it two? Is it three quarters of
choice? No, there were certainly emerging deficits in the end of last year, which is why the government produced more money short term for the NHS than was expected in the spending round.
But the 8 billion?
Yes. Well, the 8 billion plus 2 billion consolidated, so yeah. 10 in total.
Yeah.
And the NHS came out of the spending round. I would definitely not describe it as generous, but I think slightly better, with a better settlement than was expected, largely because of the intervention of Simon Stevens. Where we didn't get what we were looking for as the Confederation is a sustainable solution on social care. If you look at it as a single system, I think the weakness at the moment, the threat to stability in the health and care system, is not in the finances of individual NHS organisations, where I think there are solutions that can work. It's the relationship between the NHS and social care and the current funding stresses in social care.
Have you seen the Carter report yet?
I haven't seen it yet. No.
It's out Friday, isn't it? Yeah. It's quite centralist.
They haven't included me in their list of consultees yet, but they've clearly included you.
You are what you read.
But I have read the HSJ.
and a very fine magazine it is too. We all love the HSJ. One hears that it's quite Stalinist. It's he's got the model hospital that everyone's got to copy. I mean, is that something you really want to see?
Well, it's. I think this is something. This is one of the developing conversations. It's probably the best way of putting it. Within the sector and between the sector and the government at the moment, I do not think that you run an efficient health and care sector on the basis of a single centralised view of how it should be run, and it's often referred to as the Monday meeting culture. I'm not in favour of that. I think that it goes all the way back to 1990. That if you're going to run an effective health and care system, you have to have empowered local management. This is way beyond healthcare again. It's another much broader principle. If the guy at the top, whether you're running a health organisation or a uniform business, right back to the very beginning, if the guy at the top insists on second-guessing the decision of the guy at the front line, the next time the guy at the front line faces a difficult choice, he'll just say, "Oh, we'll refer it up to the top. He knows how to do it. He'll deal." The only way running a large organisation is that you give people space and expect them to deliver, to manage their organisation effectively. That opens the question then, how you call it to account, commissioner-provider. And it's around commissioner-provider that I think the answer lies, not what you describe as Stalinism. The history of the 20th century tells you where that leads.
Exactly. Right. Who'd like to say something? I have a question. Well, plenty. Okay. Let's start with you. Tell us who you are so we can report to your employer.
Yes, that's right. This being a Stalinist organisation.
My name's Paul. I'm CEO of Every Life.
Of what?
Every Life, a technology business that works in the social care and healthcare systems.
Oh, really? Across platforms?
No, I've spent a long time in home care and spotted a number of challenges in home care. The fact that you didn't really have a transparency on what was happening out in the community when you were managing a home care service. So this allows you to create efficiency. So what was all paper-based in terms of assessments and care planning is now what happens on tablets. And when people go and deliver the care, they get the instructions or the care plans.
My eyes are glazing over. Let's go to the question.
you get real-time feedback on what's happening. Improve the care. But when you talk about commissioner provider and you talk about the joining together of health and care, you talk about it as though that's a join that can happen because both sides can take a look at purchasing from public sector or private or charitable organisations. But there's a mismatch between the health and the social care. because whenever you talk about social care, you talk about adult social care, so you talk about local authority purchasing. But there's a big difference in the populations you serve, because if you're looking at the health side, you look after a very high percentage of the population that would be in particular reaching older age and using the health services. But when you take a look at local government procurement, that would be less than a 50% share of social care that have been procured through those routes now. A lot of that would be self-funded.
Mm-hmm.
So those local authority organisations that you're linking in with don't provide a lot of that care, aren't associated with a lot of that care anymore.
That is, actually, that is a very, it's a subtle and interesting point.
It is.
Because I did a thing the other day where I wrote about it, and the majority of people in care homes are self-funded. And the difficulty in getting people out, often who are looked after at home, is getting the care package put
mm-hmm.
in place.
Yeah.
And that's often provided. Most people do in reach and give you 6 weeks post-discharge, and then there's a tailing off period.
Yeah.
That is quite interesting, isn't it?
It absolutely is.
It's a good question.
It's an important point,
yeah.
And it is a good question, because it illustrates something that's, I think, very important. If we mean what we say, if we're going to walk the walk instead of just endlessly talking the talk of a single system, because a single system, a single health and care system, maintains the commitment to the free NHS as we've known it, but needs to engage in the development of embedding that in a system where individuals will be responsible for some of their own care, always have been. And so it's not just about the public sector as a purchaser. It's the public sector as a commissioner, if you like, responsible for the policy framework and the regulation, as well as just the purchaser.
What about a broker? That's a
yeah.
better word, a broker of care, isn't it, rather than a commissioner of care?
Well, it's one of the areas where the DILNOT proposals, whatever happens to the detail of DILNOT, the proposition that if care is a public-private partnership, it's a partnership between the taxpayer and you as an individual, me as an individual, then there has to be some kind of brokerage, and
yeah.
there has to be some
I
kind
think
of...
brokerage is a better word. And I'll come to you in a second. I just want to carry on this theme. And of course, what we haven't touched on is I suppose, the elephant in the room thing, which is that social care is means-tested.
Well, that's what we were just touching on.
I just wanted to draw
yeah.
that point out. And
yeah.
It's means-tested, and healthcare isn't means-tested.
Mm.
And where they work in increasing harmony, then that boundary becomes dangerously porous, doesn't it? And does healthcare becomes means-tested, or do we stop means-testing social care?
Mm.
And maybe we could carve out, like the Australians have, is they have a health and Department of Health and Ageing or something, which is a whole different ballgame. They've carved that out. And I just want to say this, you know, before we kind of discuss it, is, I mean, if you look at a business, if you top shop, you know that your customer is a certain age, certain demographic, requiring a certain type of product. Or if you are British Home Stores, you know, businesses define themselves around the demographic of their customer. The problem the health service has got is it's got such a broad demographic, cradle to grave, that defining itself around the needs of the customer is very difficult. And there might be an argument now with older users of the service becoming so much more frequent, and the pressures that creates, of redefining healthcare around that discrete group. And rather than just saying, we do everything, we just say we'll have a different department, not a department, even an organisation that does that.
I don't think, I mean, bearing in mind this is a public service, you can't define bits of the population out of public services. What you have got to do is to segment, is to ensure that the public service that you deliver to the elderly or to the working age disabled or to the learning disabled or to different groups in the population reflect the changing needs of that population. They're different from what they were 50 years ago. We can treat some diseases, other diseases people live with for the rest
yeah,
of their lives. It's just a different... It's an important point, Roy, because what we're dealing with is a set of institutions that in the popular image of the health service is that you're normally healthy, You get it, something happens to you, you go to the health service, they cure you, and you go out healthy again. Now, that's a relatively small proportion of what health service does. But we've got a set of institutions designed to do that. Now,
that's wouldn't what it be I'm saying, more, redesign the institution?
Yeah, well, precisely.
Yeah.
No, that's exactly, that's a point that I bore for Britain. We've got a care model which isn't designed to deliver the service that today's generation
needs. So what about the institution? Where do you think we're going to go with that?
Well, I'm not in favour of changing the free offer. I keep saying it because it's an absolutely fundamental point to get consent for necessary change in the care model. I'm not in favour of changing it. What I am in favour of is, you'll never remove them, but thinking about some of the cliff edges, the discontinuities that exist in the current funding structure that create all kinds of very perverse incentives end up with people in hospital that don't need to be there. And people often
it sounds
as though you're making a point about economics. Actually, I don't want to be in hospital unless I need to be. And if there's an opportunity to avoid me ending up in hospital, then as a person who uses this service, I'd prefer to be sustained in life outside hospital rather than ending up unnecessarily
in hospital.
I'm
not sure you've addressed the porous boundary between.
No, I have very explicitly. I said what we need to be doing, precisely the point, is thinking that some of these services are charged for. Some of them, actually, we pay for entirely ourselves. Some of them are mixed funding between individuals and the state, and some of them are free. Now, I'm not in favour of changing the free. What I am in favour of is thinking about the incentives once you get outside the free offer of this full health and care sector.
Yes, sir.
Tell us
who you are.
I'm Robert Elkeleaver. I'm a member of the CCG.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to ask you about commissioning.
Mm-hmm.
Now, your own House of Commons Select Committee did an inquiry into commissioning many years ago, before the Lansley reform,
okay. And
found that commissioning was costing 14% of the whole budget. And in addition to that, they said the evidence that commissioning actually helped in healthcare was very limited. Now, since then, we've had the Lansley reforms, which you've criticised quite rightly. The whole thing's much more complicated. There's more bureaucracy, although the idea was to reduce bureaucracy. So I would put it to you that the commissioning system is hemorrhaging money away, which could be spent on health care. And also that the system is very adversarial. So you have constant friction and tension, which you support in a way, between commissioners and providers. What I see is arguments about money, about providers saying we did this and the commissioner saying, oh no, you didn't, and we're not paying for that. I think the system is actually detrimental to healthcare, and I would put it to you that it should be abandoned.
Could you just spell out what you mean?
Well, I'll tell you what I mean.
No. I'm in danger of repeating myself.
You're stuck in the 90s, let's face it.
No, I'm not stuck in the 90s. I'm an advocate of what's going on in Greater Manchester, which is very much 2016, I think. I genuinely think what Bernstein is leading in Manchester, he's taken this further than anyone else, is the new Beveridge. I think that Beveridge was a creature of his time. And Bernstein is a creature of his time.
So, getting back to the question, the model in Manchester is, I'm going to come back to the word that occurred to me earlier, they are brokering care across platforms.
Mm-hmm.
The commissioning point that you make, I think, is well made, because there's very little evidence that commissioning has achieved anything.
Well, as I've said earlier on in the discussion, if you prefer to call it brokering rather than commissioning,
you've got to be more persuasive.
You know, a rose by any other name was written centuries ago. It's the question is whether in Manchester, to take that example, the right way of funding care in Manchester is to send money to the Christie or to the Manchester Royal Infirmary and to leave them to get on with it, or whether it's to send it to a public service commissioner and whose job it is to use pounds in Manchester, whether it comes out of the health budget, the social care budget, the criminal justice budget, the welfare budget, the attendance allowance, to use pounds in a way that delivers joined up care to a citizen or a family living in Greater Manchester. And it's my very strong view that national organisations funded from the top won't deliver, can't deliver. It's actually impossible. You said earlier on it's complicated. It's not complicated, it's impossible to deliver services that are focused on the needs of a family if you're trying to do it through national and remote bureaucracies.
Isn't that a really grandiose view and vision? Is that really achievable?
Well, the answer is yes. Frankly, it is. Come to Manchester, get on a train, go with Sir Richard. Wow. Go on a Branson train to Manchester and see what's happening.
Can I just do you were the chairman, of course, of the select committee, which I wanted to touch on. They're a complete waste of time, aren't they?
Was there any job I did in my life that you don't think was a complete waste of time?
I don't want you to take it personally, but I mean, you know, the whole select committee thing just seems to me to be a complete talk.
Politics is about the whole process of politics. You're engaged in politics when you're engaged in a discussion like this. The way I quite often illustrate this is from, again, way outside health. Who do you think was the most powerful, the most influential figure in British economic policy in the late 70s, early 80s? I'll give you my answer to that question. It's not Dennis Healey or Geoffrey Howe. It was Sam Britton, who wrote week after week after week in the FT the case for thinking about monetary policy and not believing.
Yes, that's right. Journalists have an enormous impact.
So it's the power. It's the power. It wasn't because people were frightened of the FT. God's sake, it was because he won an argument.
Yes, he did. Yeah.
And he wasn't alone. But I use the instance to make the point. And so a select committee by ourselves, we didn't. We were a contributor to a debate. But I'm quite often told that the arguments we made from the select committee were part of the evolving argument about health policy.
It does depend, I think, a bit on the membership of the committee as well. I mean, I watched the select committee the other day, and you know, you could see members that didn't really understand the health thing, and they were just kind of grandstanding for their local newspaper. And I thought, you know, what a wasted opportunity this is. It's not. You know,
we fought a civil war in the 1640s in order to protect the right of the representatives of the people to represent the views of the people without being experts.
Yes, it's not about being experts. I mean, well, look at the example we had of care dot data. I sat and watched that. Care dot data, if you look at the legislation, there's nothing in there that says that patients or the owners of the data have to give consent. There's nothing in there that says that. Mm. And then Sarah has got Tim Kelsey there and his brigade, you know. Poor old Tim has been beaten up every which way. And she says to me, why are you not seeking the patient's consent? You know, and then I don't know why he didn't say because Parliament doesn't require us to. He went through some labyrinthine bullshit of an answer. And I was sort of screaming at the telly. It's because the chairman of the select committee didn't realise it wasn't in the legislation.
No, true. But in order to get people in a free society to do what you want them to do, you have to win an argument. Democracy was famously described as government by persuasion. Government by explanations. A slightly different word. Government by explanations.
It's a very different word. Yeah.
Well, okay. If you say so.
Anybody else got anything else they want to say? Yeah, sorry, I forgot. Please tell us who you got.
Indeed.
This is not going to be a loving, is it? We're here to be nasty to them.
Listening to all the Royal Colleges and the BMA and the Confederation about what they felt should be in the manifesto pre-election, and the thing that was consistent that came out from that was no reorganisation.
Yes, absolutely.
And I think the problem that we have, and it's a bit depressing that since 1990 we've had re-legislation to try and do the same thing. And I think that the key that we need to be talking about is we need evolution. We don't need to reorganise the chairs and tables. We need to give people doing things new, stopping things that you've been doing for a long time. And I think if we could get that into the language, that we're going to make a commitment over a long period of time to make those things happen, maybe Greater Manchester is going to lead that. But I'd be interested in your views on how we can get that in the language rather than...
Mm-hmm. It's a longer cycle, it's a very good point. We've got 222 weeks before the next election. And it's not really long enough.
I'm not as directly involved in that as I used to be, so the number isn't on my mind. But,
yeah, but you are right, it does lead longer, doesn't it?
One for each CCG.
Yes, well done. Give that man an orange.
But it also gives me an opportunity, actually, thank you, Pippa, the idea that Norman Lamb actually proposed in Parliament just after Christmas.
Not this commission.
Well, this commission. It's because you like putting people in studios and telling, saying, you got this wrong, didn't you? Whereas actually, the point that's just been made is that it does need to be an evolutionary process. You'll never take health out of politics, and you should never try. But what we should be looking to do is to create, is to define the areas that the politicians disagree about in order that you can have consistency in that huge area where actually they do agree. I chaired, as you say, the Select Committee for 4 years. I mean, that had Andrew Percy, who is he's a robust member of the Tory right wing, shall we describe him that way, Graham Morris, who's a signed-up Corbynista. And we used to get the only reports on which we have votes were very narrow points about people being appointed to the Malcolm Grant. We had votes on that, and there was somebody else who was going to be a candidate for one of the national bodies. There was a vote there. The policy papers that we published from the Select Committee had Andrew Pearl in the time that he was on the committee. Andrew on the right, and Graham, as far as I remember, I think he was a member for the whole of that my time as chair. So it is possible to get a broad measure of agreement, not on everything, but where you can define the areas of agreement, I think you've done something worthwhile, which is why I'm in favour of that commission. And that's what makes possible a more evolutionary approach, because I completely agree with you. One of the simplest ways of getting a cheer from a health audience is to say I'm not in favour of top-down disorganisation. And that's what we tried to say, but it wasn't what happened, unfortunately.
Right. We've got to go back. Judith, we'll do you first, if you excuse the expression, and then we'll come to Brian.
Judith Smith from the University of Birmingham. Stephen, I just wondered, if you could have done one more inquiry as a subcommittee chair, what would it have been?
Well, the answer is that I would have gone... this may be... 2020 hindsight, but I would definitely go into the devolution agenda, because this whole sector, whether you do it through the devolution method or purchaser provider, or if you think Carter and that's the way of doing it, the core question actually is demands are changing, technology is changing, how can we get service delivery to change? It's how do you reflect necessary change in a very small C conservative and highly sensitive sector? And the devolution agenda, I think, is a genuinely new idea in this space. So that's my answer to your question.
Brian John, yeah. Professor Sir Brian John.
XGP.
known for one or two things since you were qualified as a GP, if I may say so, Brian.
As an XGP, in 1988 I was given the job of setting the resource allocation formula, which we did.
RORP?
Actually it was followed RORP. It was changing RORP a bit, yes. RORP was from 76, this was in 1988.
Too bloody old for this
guy. We've got the hospital inventory statistics data, which covered everybody, that's how we did it. And now I'm still on the ACRA advisory committee for resource allocation.
You're still on it?
I'm still on it, yes. I must have been 20 years longer than anyone else.
God.
But we allocate this stuff by roughly 100 billion and 116. And it's very much, it's, the main factors are standardised mortality ratio and social factors, and you don't allocate for supply. That's how it's done. And so you get, if you take various bits of it, like public health bit, the public health bit, for instance, is done mainly on the standardised mortality ratio to the age of 75. I wanted it to be the square root of it. That's how it's done. And it gives a ratio of the allocation from the poor, from the low, the poor and the high HSMRs to the other, which is the low HSMRs and the rich, 7 times per head. Less ratio in other things, so that the health service, and I think it's paid for, what you call free, but it's paid for by taxation.
Mm-hmm.
I think about 5% of the population pay for about 75% of the total. Bevin wanted universal coverage, but I think he also quite wanted universal payment as well. And so that means that the it would be quite straightforward-ish to do the same for public services, as you say, the other services. Relatively easy.
Yeah. Yeah.
The same method. So that would mean, say, Manchester, the formula would allocate to these areas very large sums of money to the poorer areas, the poorer people, and the opposite, but the payment would be the other way around.
Mm-hmm.
Now the question is, sorry to take so long, is the aim to try to devolve down also the payment of it? I mean, you talked, I think, at one stage, you said local, regional government, didn't you? You made that comment. Is that what one of the aims is, that people in Manchester and all the industries there are used to fund some of Manchester areas? Because you would, with the formula we have now, we get very large variations
mm-hmm.
in the payment, and we get very large variations in who it goes to, the other way around. And that's a progressive way of doing things.
It's an equalisation.
So these are reality things, $100 billion everything.
We're going to have to get to the question.
Ask the question.
Yeah, yeah.
Are you aiming to devolve down the
And what will it mean for Surrey?
Well, I mean, Surrey or in the northwest or northeast,
no,
it's very different.
I mean, what I think you're asking me is, do I recognise that if we go the route that I've been advocating, that there has to be the same commitment to equalisation of tax revenues against demand,
yes,
as is the practical effect of the health service funding formula?
Indeed.
And the answer to that question is yes.
Yes.
The idea that it could be, I can see how it could, if you were so inclined, there could be a fear that what this is all about, just having local funding and moving away from national equalisation, and the answer to that is absolutely not.
Yes, because I think it's going to be much clearer of the differences once you actually...
I mean, clearly, if you're doing the funding allocations across a broader range of public services, then, as always with these funding formulae, you start with where what the current structure is and what you might like to go to in a perfect world, and then it's a question of how fast you move from... and all that.
But it is, I mean, it's a very good point, isn't it? Because, you know, two turkeys don't make an eagle.
The current evolution of local authority spending is having a greater emphasis on local tax base to support local
exactly.
services. And I absolutely acknowledge that if we're going to go that route with the health service, then the commitment to national equalisation.
It's going
to
be very difficult.
Well,
very clear, you see.
The simple way of getting from where we are to the kind of world that I'm describing is one where the local authority is constituted as the agent of NHS England. That way the funds flow as they do currently.
We need brokers.
But
that's
we shall need
world.
To evolve beyond that.
Brokers, I've solved it. Now, can you, we finish at 5:30 because I don't get paid for working after 5:30. Can
you sound like a junior doctor.
Can you just be broker? Do you think they should go on strike? Now, who thinks the junior doctor should go on strike? Put your hand up. Who thinks the junior doctor shouldn't go on strike? Put your hand up. Let the record show, overwhelmingly they don't, apart from Michael, who's a doctor. And what does he know? Right.
Right. One of the things that you frequently come back to is the importance of distributing responsibility and leadership and all that stuff. you quoted Stanley McChrystal and his book Team of Tea.
I did.
Fabulous book. One of the things that he says very, very clearly in the world which is increasingly interconnected and complex is that driving for efficiency is counterproductive, and that you need to drive for resilience, and resilience comes from giving very strong clarity of purpose and a permissive world. And why aren't we stopping Carter?
Well, okay, can you do that in 90 seconds?
I think I haven't read Patrick Carter's report, the latest report. I have read what he wrote about agency nursing and purchasing efficiencies, which is all good common sense stuff, but doesn't change the world, frankly. What we need to do, I'm repeating myself. One thought, perhaps concluding thought, is that it flows from everything that I've said, that I am in favour of devolved management, I am in favour of empowering local teams. It's right back to the very first point you made, actually, about how you get people to engage with their employers, and how it's the NHS recruits idealists at the age of 18 and turns them into cynics by the time they're 40.
Yes.
That's not a success. So engaging with people and enabling them to make a fulfilling contribution, that requires local empowerment. That's all relatively standard management stuff. The difficult public policy issue is how, with that myriad of service delivery structures, you call it to account. The difficult bit is what the commissioning process needs to look like. And that's the bit that we've talked about since 1990, but we haven't developed, partly because we are forever changing the structure.
I think we just need to get
rid
of it, and we need brokers. But you are right. Guess what I'm going to be writing about this week? who's read Team of Teams? I've recommended it strongly in my email. Yeah, it's a good book, isn't it? I like that. But I tell you,
remember what, Milton, old commissioner is new broker writ large.
Listen, it's a new idea. You heard it here first. What was I going to say about? I forgot what I was going to say. Now. Gosh, I've got the early onset of something horrible.
hunger.
Is it hunger? No. The Team of Teams was and is a very good book. On the Carter thing, I remember what I was going to say now. On the Carter thing, I think that one of Patrick Carter's strongest messages will be. There are people out there working their socks off, but they don't know what good looks like. Mm. And we have to have a much better way of showing people what good looks like. Because if you're running an orthopod department in a hospital somewhere other, and you're working your ass off, and you're doing, and somebody comes along with a set of numbers for a hospital like yours and says, you know what, and you think, Jesus, how do they do that? Mm. Which is really what the Academy of Fabulous Stuff is about. We want to share best practice. I think we've shared a fabulous evening this evening, don't you? It's 5:30. Can we say thank you to Stephen? We always like to give our guests a little gift. It's a very it's a bit eclectic for us. It's a very special gift.
Oh wow!
It is a bottle of a Welsh whiskey.
Welsh whiskey. Thank you very much.
Which is the finest whiskey in the world. And we'd be cave. And
you haven't heard about the result of the referendum, clearly.
No. And the reason we've chosen it is that it is quite expensive, as you would expect. And pearls before swine in some cases, of course. But never mind. But what will amuse you is it's just over the limit that ministers have to declare as a gift, which is lost on you now.
Lost on me now.
We just like the idea of having a gift from Roy Lilly written in the register. You've been a wonderful guest, Stephen. Thank you very much. And if you've been watching us on Proscope, I hope you've had a great evening, and thank you very much for joining us. And we'll see you again next time when we have the delights of Sir Mike, whatever his name
Richards.
Is. Sir Mike Rickards, Richards, the bloke from the CQC. Right.
Can I just say, ladies and gentlemen, the next Health Chat is actually on the 11th of February.